Welcome, and thank you for joining the Strategic Planning 2018 webinar on how to increase your bottom line. I'm Amanda Jader, the Director of Portfolio Management at Tricom. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, Tricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series, designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Staffing business owners and executives are responsible for developing a strategic business plan that defines the company's annual goals and allocates its resources in pursuit of these objectives. Increasing your bottom line is accomplished in two ways: increasing sales and increasing profitability. In today's edition of the Tricom Industry Insider webinar, we are joined by three senior executives from Tricom who will share their staffing industry-specific knowledge of how to increase your profitability in your staffing business operations through markup versus gross profit, break-even report, detailed gross profit, client selection, order fill priority list, unemployment rates and limits, work opportunity tax credit, and direct deposit. By the end of this session, you'll know the analytics behind increasing your operational profitability. Our presenters today are Julianne. Julianne is the president and CEO of Tricom. Rick Gerke, he is the director of cash management and COO. And Mary Jo Heim, Director of Accounting, CFO. With that, I will turn the floor over to Julianne, Rick, and Mary Jo.
Good morning to some of you and good afternoon to others. This is Julianne Bittner, and we're glad to have you on our webinar today. If you haven't been on in a webinar with Mary Jo and I or Rick and I, you'll now get to know that we kind of bounced off of each other. We like to do that because each of us has our own thoughts and input into the subject. And we're calling from today from good old Wisconsin, where we are at a nice 2 degrees. I think we finally got over a crisp and brisk 2 degrees today. We were below zero yesterday and the day before. So lucky for all you who are south of us. The first item we talk about here is markup versus gross profit. And it's, you know, back in the 90s, all you heard was markup, markup, and markup was king. And when you did commissions for your salespeople, all the commissions were paid by sales. Well, that has changed over the years, but it's interesting when I'm on the road or talking with prospects on the phone or even clients that today clients still are looking at markup, wholly markup alone, and not looking at another factor, gross profit, to determine if they should be working with a customer or really what is the profitability that they're bringing to the organization. So we're going to dive into that a little bit more this morning. Let's go to our next slide, the break-even analysis tool. Now, Tricom has its own version of a break-even analysis tool, and we're going to talk about that. But even if you're not a Tricom client, there is a way for you to get to that break-even or zero profit and then work your way up from that to find out your gross profit of a candidate to a customer. So the goal of the tool is to calculate the markup necessary to cover your payroll, employer taxes, workers' compensation expenses. All of those are referred to as burden, and then any admin or funding costs that you may incur with working with another provider. Now, it's very hard to use the funding costs when you're looking at daily interest because you don't know the turn of your receivables. But if you have the average turn, say 60 days or 30 days, you can then calculate what 30 days cost of funds would cost you and use that in your formula. Let's break down those components a little bit more. Mary Jo, how about you take the two critical components of the break-even tool?
Okay, so the break-even tool, you have your base of the pay rate. So you're going to have whatever you're paying per hour for an employee on an hourly basis, 15, 20, whatever the dollar amount that you're paying. And you're going to, you obviously need to associate that in addition with a workers' comp code. So you'll have those two, that information, and then you're looking at your taxes, your burden, as Julianne discussed, your FICA, your FUTA, your SUTA. All those combined are considered your burden. Now, a couple features that we need to have on our slide, you see that we're talking about the FICA rate being 7.65, which is standard, and then the FUTA rate being 0.6. Something to take into consideration is obviously those of you in California are very well known that the FUTA rate for California in 2017 was 2.1%. So what's important is we need to make sure that if you're looking at something in California that you're actually using that correct FUTA in your burden, otherwise you're going to end up sorely low on what you're charging your clients. And then your SUTA rate is going to be what your company's unemployment rate is. We tend to use that consistently throughout. We don't look at the case if someone goes over limits or anything. You really want to have that all packed in. So that number there between your pay and adding your burden, that's really your basic cost of that employee per hour. And then we look at, as Julianne just discussed, the cost of funds calculation. In other places, you may consider other costs that you have if it's a per hour cost. If the client needs you to, maybe you put in your cost of background checks, you put in your cost of drug testing, if you're not charging the employees for that. Other choices is state of California, or state of Washington has a B&O tax. So you might want to include that in part of your burden.
Sometimes clients will put a 1% overhead cost inside of their burden just to cover the cost of running the operation so that that's considered in there to get, again, to cover some of those expenses to get to a zero gross profit or a zero break even and then work their way up from there.
And we can't stress enough for those of you that are clients listening to this, if you don't have this from us yet, you should definitely ask us for it. It's a great tool, not just as owners, but for your sales staff. That's what we see a lot of clients is really, you know, they're learning it, you know, through us, and then they bring it into their salespeople, and it's an excellent tool. So we encourage you to contact us if you don't already have this from us.
Mary Jo, go into the fact that, you know, many clients, once they figure out what that break-even is and how they're looking for set gross margin, or they're using this, this tool in the bottom section of it, for greater dynamic things that they can reuse to run their business.
Right. Historically, this tool was used for really a bad placement, right? We recall, so they call and say, okay, I need to just, this wasn't a great placement, I just need to cover my costs, what do I bill out? So that's originally what it was used, but there's a lot of other uses for this. What we tend to use it for here is a lot of what-if scenarios. So I may work with someone and say, they're saying they're on a, they have an on-site, and the client says, my client wants me to cover the price of an on-site manager. So what you can do with this tool is you can determine how many hours they need to bill in order to cover that on-site person. You can use it for simply overhead. Everyone generally knows what their cost of overhead is for their office. So you'll be able to work backwards and how many hours do I need to bill using this gross profit in order to cover my overhead. And that's your basic goal. So, you know, each week you can say, okay, I need 200 hours, I need 300 hours billed at this markup. And as Rick said, for salespeople, there's a lot set up where you can set this program up that says, all right, I need someone to, I'm not going to let my salespeople do any deals that doesn't have 25% gross profit. So we can make this work simply as simple as if the little box here is green, I can go forward. If it's not green, I can't go forward. So there's a lot of important uses for this tool other than just give me my break even and what my burden covers.
Yeah, my major message would be, don't just look at markup, because you can have a 135 or 140 markup in light industrial and still not be profitable with that placement. We have spent many times going through both the break-even tool and the detailed gross profit, which we're going to go into next, with clients and showing them that the markup they have is not profitable, that they're not even covering their true expenses for that placement, or they're at like a 2% profit, well, that is not going to get you anywhere in your business to make money. So we recently did a case study. It'll be coming out on our website in January with a client who came to us about 5-6 years ago, high billings, really high billings, very low profitability, could not understand why he wasn't profitable. Well, when Rick and I spent about a year with him going through one client at a time, looking at both the break-even tool and the detailed gross profit, we were able to show him where the columns were that he was not profitable in. So this is a great tool to start with, or even to look at if you currently have placements out and see with what else you could be, are you covering everything? Definitely a tool for your salespeople before they go out and start quoting rates. And again, don't focus only on markup. You got to have both tools, markup, and you have to look at gross profit. So let's look at detailed gross profit now. Another report that Tricom offers, but again, you can be doing this on your own with your own spreadsheet. The components of it, and I'm going to have Rick take over this because this is an area that he spends a lot of time with clients with, as well as I do, but let's have Rick talk a little bit.
Okay, the detailed gross profit, I can't think of how long ago we designed it, but I know that there is a trend in the industry where clients used to pay commission on gross sales, and we saw that trend changing to net gross profit. So we designed a tool at the time that we thought would be used mostly for commissions. And since then, it has really kind of developed into not only a tool for that, but also a profitability tool, which is what we really spend time with our clients on. So the components of the report that you get from Tricom, you start off with your gross billing, so it's a landscaped report in a spreadsheet format, and it takes your gross billings and then your gross payroll, and then it will outline all the burdens. So it'll list the taxes together, the workers' comp, Tricom's fee. You do have the ability to put in a miscellaneous fee or an overhead fee if you so choose, and it will take you to the net gross profit. And then you are allowed, or you're able to attach sales reps to that net gross profit, and we can attach, I think, up to 7 sales reps per item there. Now, this will give you the total gross profit on a particular customer, but it will also take it down to the employee level. So it shows you markup, it shows you basically everything you need to see for that particular employee, that particular customer, and then it rolls it up for the entire week for you as well. So it is an advantage when you are full service with Tricom to have that tool and really measure your profitability. And that is what Julian was talking about before when we were working with a particular client and showing him where he was profitable and where he wasn't and how he should focus his business on certain customers that already had a healthy markup or, you know, work with existing customers to raise that markup because obviously everybody is looking for profitability on this.
Yeah, at the end of the day, a detailed gross profit report will help you determine, do you need to go back to a customer and ask for increase in rates, and why is it you can speak more intelligently on why you need to get those rates that you're asking for. And later in our presentation today, we're going to talk about really what's going on in the marketplace today and why so many of you are struggling to grow your business and what you can do to grow that by looking at your detailed gross profit and looking at your break even and spending time where those accounts are more profitable to you in various ways. So we'll talk about that now with the client selection. Oh, you want
detailed gross profit. Just one other topic for those of you who might not be with Tricom right now and how this report can work in your scenarios. Julian and I see a lot of financial statements from a lot of places, and very seldom do we see an actual gross profit calculation that's on a financial statement.
Right.
So if you're not a Tricom client, what you need to be doing is you see these accounts. You need to speak with your accountant, and you need to say, you know, and I need to be able to see what my gross profit is. In the market, we're seeing a lot of accountants who are posting workers' compensation based off of payment, not on actual cost. We're also seeing they're not breaking out all your payroll expenses as we're relating here in a section by itself, what we like to call, you know, cost of billing. So you could literally have, here's my billing on top, and then here, where are all my payroll costs? Please group them together into a few accounts so I can actually get a subtotal of what my gross profit is, so I can know what my gross profit percent is. That is not an unrealistic request from people who are, you know, having outside accountants do their stuff or doing stuff in QuickBooks. That is something that is easily done, and that is not an, it should not be a difficult request for an accountant to give you, because this is a number, whether you're with Tricom or not, that you need to be able to see on, at least on a monthly basis for your financials.
Unfortunately, it's a lot. I mean, I'm not trying to diss the accountants and your industry, Mary Jo, but a lot of them do not understand staffing. And unfortunately, when they're doing the presentation of financial statement, it is not in a financial presentation that is best for the owner. It really is what they're comfortable with. And your people, your contractors, your temporary employees, your independent contractors, those are your, that's your product, your you know, so you've got your billing, but that's your cost of goods. And you have to have those people and all the related expenses of those people above the line. Then your internal staff goes below the line. And that's when you can really get a handle on your gross profit. So unfortunately, a lot of the accounting world out there is still doing financial statements what they're comfortable with, and they're not understanding the difference with staffing and how to present that is best for you. So let's look at client selection now. And feel free to ask any questions if you have any as we're going through this presentation today. We forgot to mention that earlier. Key factors in selecting a client. So we talk about profitability. That's your biggest thing. So as you're looking at your detailed gross profit report, where are you spending their time in putting placements at today? Are you putting in your most profitable clients? Or are you putting in with clients just because you've been with your customer for your client for 8 years, 9 years? And so you're spending all your time filling those jobs and those open orders, but yet those open orders are very low gross profit margins. Or next thing is the days outstanding, the payment terms. Maybe they have low payment terms, or I should say high payment terms, so they're turning at 60 days or 75 days. Risk of the client. Look at your two risks that are really important when selecting a client or continuing to work with a client. Credit risk. What is the credit risk? If you're working with Tricom, we can run a credit report for you and go over that credit report for you, with you. The other one is, are you looking at the injuries? Are you going in there and looking at OSHA logs and seeing what the injuries are at that location or that customer? Because that will add up to dollars in your pocketbook later on. Why are they looking to use you for staffing? This is a big one that Mary Jo and I are always digging into when somebody says, oh, they want to payroll with us. Really? They want to do payrolling. Why do they want to do payrolling with you? Well, the number one reason that they are going to payroll with you is because they have high workers' comp costs. Why do they have high workers' comp costs? Look at their OSHA logs. They have high accidents at their location. The other reason is they have high unemployment rates. And so those are two cost factors that they want to then eliminate from their business expense, and they want to outsource. The third that we didn't talk about is really their profitability. They are having some issues with profitability, their financial statement, their cash flow, and therefore they're going to use you to payroll, but they want 30 or 60 days. Basically what they're doing is they're utilizing you as a bank. You are now their banker, and I don't think you nor I are in the business of being a banker to the third party, which are your clients. So those are some big factors that I think you need to look at that sometimes you forget. Mary Jo, do you have anything on that?
Yeah, just a little bit about the payrolling. As a supplemental to billing, we either are payrolling for an existing client or someone says, you know, I want you to just take my whole internal staff and just process the payroll. Well, we all know that the markup is not great on those. But the things that we need to consider on that is, I mean, clients have talked to me about it when I talk to them, and they say, well, you know, it's just some money that's going into the over, you know, to cover my overhead, and it's not a lot of work. But the things we need to consider with that is, you know, as Julianne talked about, you know, the workers' comp, the OSHA. So one accident, the thing you have to remember on a payrolling account, one accident Now, that's going to affect your entire workers' comp rate for all of your employees. So, or a lot of unemployment claims. You know, if they end up laying off people when they're now under you, that's going to affect all your employees. So, very easily that small profit can get eaten up by one accident or, you know, a few large workers' comp claims or unemployment claims, and that affects your entire employee base. So those are considerations you want to think about when you're thinking, oh, this payrolling is really easy and it's easy money and I should continue to do it.
I think everybody, you know, is looking for sales. That's the biggest thing is people look at that top line and everybody wants to bring in new sales, but what people don't realize is more sales doesn't always mean more profitability. And that's really the point we're trying to drive home here is all of these factors are so important. One code on that workers' comp could eat into your pocketbook like you wouldn't believe. So sometimes you just need to be careful, and maybe saying no, you know, keeps you more profitable.
And I'll mention now, I mean, if any of you are currently clients, the three of us, any one of us will be willing to walk through your reports with you and go one client at a time, one customer at a time, and see if there's some room where you should be changing either your bill rates or if you really want to do business with them. In the case study that we're about to release, we were able to raise his profitability tremendously, and he's been a very successful client now. And it's all due to he and Rick and I sitting down and really working through his accounts. And Rick, the credit really goes to Rick and him because they really spent more time on it than I did at the end, every week going through those customers and raising that profitability. But now when they go out and they sell a customer, they use the tools that we've coached them on, and they make their decisions based on those tools. So I think it could be very useful to you in 2018 to get your profit margins up. Let's talk about order fill priority lists. So we all know that there's a labor shortage right now. And so how do you grow your business in the labor shortage? Well, it was interesting as you go out and talk to owners, and I think it was one day Mary Jo and I are like, why are they doing this? Why are they not looking to fill the orders that are more profitable to them than the orders, again, that are not as profitable? So evaluate your current clients. Look at the risk and the payment terms and the profitability, and see if that's where you should be spending your time filling those orders. If you have limited resources, which is employees or contractors, where are you going to place them? Are you placing them with the most profitable customers or the high-risk customers? Are you placing them with clients whose receivables turn terrible for you and you're always going after money? Or are you placing them with people, clients, who pay you on time, so therefore it affects your cash flow? Fill the most profitable client first, and supply and demand. Review all your unfilled job orders today. Look at them and look at, with your team, who do you focus on first? Which are your profitable customers that have orders that are unfilled, and which ones are just at really low markups and are not going to bring profitability into you? We've had a few clients start doing this in 2017, and even though there's a labor shortage, they were able to grow their business because it wasn't necessarily adding a ton of more people out. It was replacing the people, moving the placements to more profitable customers for their book of business. Anything else on that? Anybody?
I think that's a great tool to use.
Okay, I'm going to turn this over to Mary Jo on unemployment rates and limits, because we're getting to a new year here and everything's going to reset next week.
All right, so how can I be more profitable as it relates to unemployment? What does that mean? How can unemployment make me more profitable? Well, in a couple ways. First of all, I know it seems basic, but try to retain your employees, okay? Because very, very seldom, if you're turning everyone all the time, you're not going to hit those limits. You're not going to hit those unemployment limits. And if you can keep people to hit the 7,000 feudal limit, that is going to save you money as opposed to taking the next person and moving forward. So obviously, retention is important to the employees. It's even more important now in the marketplace that we're at, but it's really important in unemployment. Answering claims. I'm going to use New Jersey as a great example. If you do not, New Jersey requests information both on disability and unemployment. If you do not send back the information that New Jersey requests of you, they charge you what's called a DAS penalty. So that not only is it costing you because your unemployment rate is going to go up, but it also costs you because now you have penalties on top. Maryland is the same way. They also charge penalties if you're not filling out their information. Another way that unemployment is going to help you, obviously, fight claims. Okay, we are in a very low unemployment marketplace. If you're just letting claims go through as opposed to answering them and making sure you're answering them on a timely basis and saying there is a work available and the person, you know, didn't take the work, that's pretty much the answer for most of them. A little clue I put in here that'll help you is if you're not familiar with the SIDES system, the SIDES is the State Information Data Exchange System. That is meant for high volume unemployment claims and multi-state employment claims. This is a system, and if you go to this SIDES.org, it'll get you information. If you go to this system, you can get yourself set up and you can do everything in one place as far as unemployment claims. Not all states, there are 50 localities, so almost all states have some use that you can either use it for claims or you can use it to check information or you can use it for, you know, verification of employment. There's a lot of different things, but SIDES will let you take less hours in working on unemployment claims and working on things that deal with unemployment. The other item is when you're considering going into a new state, we all want to expand, and nowadays you don't just work generally in the state that your offices are in, but you need to do the research when you're entering new states. I'm going to use California as an example. I mentioned it earlier. If you're new to California and you're going into California because you have there's an opportunity to do one person, you might want to reconsider a couple things as you're going into it. Number one, as I mentioned, at least for 2017, the FUTA rate is not 0.6 like it is all over the country. It's 2.1%. It is going to go up again if they don't pay their federal loans in 2018, but it's at least 2.1% right now. That's something to consider, and you need to make sure you're using that when you're using your break-even and your burden information. Then the other item is for California is the franchise tax. Franchise, if you're doing any business in California, they're going to charge you $800 franchise tax. Okay, so that needs to be something that you consider before you're going into that state. Are you going to make $800 in order to pay $800 of tax? I think what I've known historically is a lot of clients have gone into California, done a little bit of business, and came out. If you're going into other states, specifically California, make sure you're talking to your tax accountant as well, because a lot of times the tax accountant is not filing in California, even though the work is done in California, and California requires it. So not only do you have this franchise tax of $800, but then you have penalties and interest because you're not paying your corporate taxes. So unemployment, have someone, you know, if you have a large volume, have someone assigned to it. Make sure it takes the priority and these things get addressed to keep your unemployment, because again, once that unemployment rate goes up, that's going to affect all your clients, all your customers, all your clients, all your employees across the board in one state. So it's important to spend some time on that, and you can really save yourself some money.
I don't really think people consider all those things when they're going into a new state, especially California, some, even Pennsylvania. When we tell people, if you want to go to Pennsylvania, you better know the sales tax. And there's so many different variables in every state that I don't think an owner understands that. And so if they're not working with Tricom, Mary Jo, where would they go before they would go into a state to get that information or that learn more about what that state has?
Well, on our website, we have a sort resource document that has a document for every state and Puerto Rico and D.C., and it talks about, does it have sales tax for staffing? What is the new employer unemployment rate? So when I'm trying to figure out my item, what are some other, are there employer taxes? You know, do I have to have a disability plan? Do I have to have, you know, is there mandatory sales tax? What, there's just a number of different things that are there local taxes? I mean, a lot of people, there are not a lot of states with local taxes, but there's, how do I do the local taxes? What are my requirements? Your first place I would recommend is going to our resources. Your second place is you need to go to the state's website, because every state works differently whether you have to have a license to do business. Now, our TRICOM clients, we worry about unemployment, we worry about withholding, but you need to check on every single state's website to see if you have to have a license to do business. In some cases, you actually need to have an address there, and that would be you'd require a registered agent. Well, on our website, we have a vendor, it's called CT Solutions, that can be a registered agent for you. It all varies depending on what states. Colorado, you know, requires certain rules different than California, different than New Mexico. So everybody needs to, I would recommend going to our website first and then go to the state's website doing business in that state.
Do we update the state when the FUTA has been adjusted, like a California situation? Is our tool for California say that it's at the 2.0? Whatever rate it is?
It doesn't. It says the FUTA reduction rate. When we had all those states, when there was 18 states that had different FUTA reductions, it's on the tab. It'll talk about the FUTA reduction piece of that.
It's under state tools, I believe it's called. It's under resources on our website.
Okay.
Now, under 2018, we do not have the updates in there yet.
Right.
We're still gathering those updates. They usually don't get out there until end of January, beginning of February, when we get the 2018, all the information compiled and then ready to load up on the website. But you would have 2017's information out there today.
Which is a good starting point. The sales tax, there's very few sales tax rates that have changed, but the sales tax states are in there. They're consistent. That information's all there. There's also a tab for unemployment wage limits. So you will see what the wage limits are. I have to give you that. For 2017 and 18. So we have seven, you'll see 17 and you'll see 18 and you'll have your wage limits. So you can see how important it is for the retention. You know, it might be more difficult if you're in Washington State. Their limit is $32,000 for unemployment. But, you know, in Florida, your wage limit is $7,000. So you'll be able to kind of gauge better whether that retention piece is really going to be affect you depending on what state you're at.
Right. Very good. Yeah, sometimes, Mary Jo, if they go to their regular accountant, they don't have this information because the accountant, again, only knows the information for their state probably, and they're not too familiar with another state's information, and you have to pay to have them investigate it.
Right.
Correct?
Absolutely. There's a cost. There's always a cost to that. On top of that, just because it's an accountant doesn't necessarily mean that they know payroll. Payroll, accounting is one piece. Payroll is a specialty of accounting, just like tax is a specialty of accounting. So your tax accountant may not necessarily know payroll rules, or your tax accountant may not necessarily know nexus rules as far as you're sending people to other states. Your tax accountant may not know how to do taxes in another state. I mean, that's important. You need to determine whether they've done taxes. Generally speaking, they're going to say they know how to do it, but have they done it? You know, have they done taxes in other states for staffing companies? It's going to make a big difference
right,
for you.
Right. Very good. So the next item here is work opportunity taxes, tax credit. We've been talking about this for years now, for the last about 3 or 4 years. You've been working at it with clients. We've seen a lot of great results for profit to add profit to the company. But then there's all new things happening over the last 2 weeks. Everybody knows there's been tax reform, and it's been signed. And there's a lot of push now for things to get done in 2017 versus 2018 because it's going to be very different. But work opportunity tax credit came up on this whole tax bill. So what's the latest that we know?
Well, what we originally knew is the Senate plan did not address work opportunity tax credit. Prior to this tax law, their work opportunity tax credit was in place through 2019. Now, the Senate plan, which didn't go anywhere, said nothing about it. Work opportunity tax credit initially was ending on 12/31/2017 in the original House plan.
But we all know that that was modified, and right now, because we, you know, we haven't been given all the information that's available in there, we really don't know. We know that you're going to be clear through 2017, all the processing through 2017. We're really not sure what the final law, if it addresses it or if it leaves it alone and goes through 2019 right now. So when we're looking for it, we're keeping track of it, and we'll be able to, we'll have announcements on our website when we find out about it. We just don't know right now. In regard to 2017, there are some states that are really up to date on their processing of certifications of work opportunity tax credits, and there are other states, as there always are, that are behind. So we'll continue to process all the 17s available, and when everything's available, we'll make sure we get our clients all their information they have for 2017.
So keep an eye on our website. We will notify you once we have seen all the line items with the new tax credit reform, and when we see the description and, or the explanation of the work opportunity tax credit and what's going to happen with that. But as Mary Jo said, you're good through 17. It's just that we don't know about 18 yet. I would say if we don't hear anything, keep doing it. Keep gathering the information. Keep filling out the forms because you don't want to have to go back. So don't stop yet, and we'll determine and find out what we learn in January and get it out there, but you don't want to stop gathering information when you know, first part of the year.
Right, if you recall, I think it was in 2015, the actual WOTC tax credit wasn't in place until September of 2015. So as Julianne said, just keep processing, and then we'll continue to do what we're doing, and we'll know, you know, they'll continue on and see what the states have to say and see what the federal government has to say.
You got to believe that there'll be some type of tax credit out there. You and I spoke yesterday more about, you know, veterans.
Right.
Maybe a tax credit for veterans. So we feel that there's going to be some form of credit out there. We just don't know what it's going to look and feel like, if it's going to change. So, again, keep doing it. And then from when we learn more about it, then we can react to it. Third item, or last item here, is the direct deposits and pay cards. What's the benefit to your staffing company with using direct deposit and pay cards? So let's talk about these a little bit. This will bounce back and forth with the three of us because we each work in different areas of this on a daily basis. I was on a phone yesterday with a client who only uses us for funding only, and so processes her own payroll through a service, and she has $20,000 in fraud hit her account this month. And so, no, she has fraud protection. She is not coming out of her pocket, but yet there's an expense to her. There's time wasted trying to get all this resolved with both the bank and some of the other outlets that were used for this fraud. So that is a problem. Check 21. Mary Jo, you want to talk about Check 21?
Sure. So Check 21 is brought on where it's great for you if you're cashing a check, and what Check 21 is the image that you can deposit an image. It works really great for the person doing it. You can deposit the image, that's great, and then you're still holding this physical check. What we found is, you know, we don't like to think this way, but what happens is that the employee takes the image and sends it to the bank and deposits it, gets their deposit, and then they take the physical check and goes to a check cashing place and deposits it and gets the cash there. So what happens? So the law is that the person who takes the image or the bank is then liable, okay, which sounds great, except for you're in the middle of this. So you have a check cashing place that sends you a note, because what would have happened is if the person's on positive pay, if the client is on positive pay, and they get a second presentment of the same check, they're going to kick it back to the check cashing place. And everybody's familiar, the check cashing place contacts you and says, you know what, we're supposed to get paid. Well, in reality, what's supposed to happen is the check cashing place is supposed to go back to the bank. But we all know that that doesn't happen. So, you know, do you want to spend your time being the intermediary between your check cashing place and your bank? Because in reality, it's not your liability, it's the bank's liability. But if you did, if we weren't using paper checks, none of this situation would occur.
Right. No. Right. Holder in due course. How about stop payment? Sorry.
Yeah, that's another thing with checks. Again, you're talking to the check cashing place. I'm sure everybody's familiar with it. You put a stop payment on a check, but they cashed at a check cashing place or a grocery store. Those particular entities do not have to see if there's a stop payment on this check. So therefore, again, the check cashing place calls you. In this case, you actually are liable. So I think what we always say, you know, when we talk to clients, it's a cost of doing business. So again, that goes away if you're not using paper checks. A check cashing place and a grocery store do not have to see, they're not able to get into the banking system and see if there's a stop payment on that check. So you're thinking you're safe, you pay for a stop payment, and then a check clears anyway. So if you're not using paper checks, if you're not using that, all that kind of time and trouble and expense goes away as well.
Okay, payroll account fraud. For anybody that's not a TRICOM client using us for your payroll, you need to make sure that your bank has payroll protection on your account, has basically, positive pay on your account. Yes, there is a fee for that, so there is a cost for that. You need that on your account. Fraud today is just, it's running through the system at a high rate. Even we experience here at TRICOM, many fraud checks getting presented where we can see that a check was lifted, and they call it washing a check, and then it was presented 15, 20 times all over. Sometimes if it's been presented too many times and there's been a lot of fraud, we actually have to shut down that account and open up another account, which we always have on standby. But these are things, if you're doing your own payroll account, that are going to cost in your business. And those are ways, there are ways to get rid of those costs by going to direct deposit and pay cards. Lost checks, you know, packages. It's the last couple of weeks here with the rise in everybody ordering online and overnight and your Amazons of the world and packages being shipped. There were a lot of payroll packages that sat at UPS and FedEx over the last couple of weeks. And there's been packages completely lost with checks in them. The mail destroys your checks. They will lose checks. U.S. Postal Service has a habit of doing that. So, again, those are all additional costs that you have to pay to replace the check, to get the check printed, to, you know, the time and your staff doing that, and then making sure that that check, that lost check, doesn't get in the hands of somebody that then now uses it for fraud on your account. So, again, live checks today, you're seeing that go away, get less and less in the payroll industry, where more and more clients and companies are saying to their employees, we're not giving you live checks. These are your options, direct deposit or pay card. Another one is stolen identity, a lot of that happening in this world today. And then the cost of delivering checks, are you looking at the cost of every time you have to have somebody go and physically deliver checks to your customer? How about the lost revenue that you have when your employees leave your sites, their customers, your customers, early to go cash their checks? How about the risk, the cost, the security of your employees, your internal staff at the office, waiting for people to come and pick up checks? So those are all the costs of what I would consider delivering checks, live checks. When you go to direct deposit or pay cards, at least with us, you go to NatPay, which then gives you email alerts, text messages, and that related to your check. You don't get a physical check email sent to you anymore. You can get an email, or you can get, like I get this morning, I got a text alert that said my account was, my checking account had a deposit in it, and then I also got a text alert with my pay stub. So those are different options of getting delivery today, and everybody has a mobile phone, it seems like. I don't think anybody out there is walking around without a mobile device. So these are great deliveries. Rick, talk about pay cards a little bit. We have a provider we work with, but there's many providers out there.
We looked into pay cards probably about 12 years ago now, I think, because we have several clients where we understand in your industry that your employees maybe don't have bank accounts or can't get bank accounts. So we were seeking a partnership and a solution for you, and we partnered with Rapid Paycard or Rapid Financial out of Florida. They are a preferred vendor of ours where we set you up with them, and they provide a pay card program where you offer pay card to your employee and you set it up online, and it prints out a form that you send to Tricom, and we set it up, and it functions just like a bank account. You can even link a savings account to it where the employee could have X amount of dollars taken out of their checking account attached to the pay card and put into a savings. They're able to pay bills with it. They're able to also get text alerts and email alerts, just like we do with the e-pay stubs Julianne was referring to. There is no cost to you. There is a minor cost to the employee, either a flat monthly fee or a per transaction fee. Our vendor is very flexible with setting that fee structure up with you and what works best for your employees. But we have quite a few clients utilizing it now. We'd like to have more. You know, obviously, the less flat checks, the less issues that we just discussed. So.
Well, and for those transient employees that you have, well, it's a great resource is a pay card. The other thing we were talking about somebody yesterday where they were saying the one who had the fraud is she's trying to get everybody now on direct deposit and pay cards. There are laws in every state before you can demand this or mandate it, I should say. I know our vendor, Rapid, knows each of the laws in every state and how to get around that or how to work with those laws. What one thing they do is basically per payroll cycle, your first transaction is free. And so, therefore, the employee could get their entire check off the pay card for free each payroll cycle if they did it all in one lump sum. So there are ways to do that. There's also ways to really teach your employees, educate your employees on how to reduce their fees on a weekly basis or monthly basis. So it's really good for transient staff. It also, the client was making a conversation or it was explained to Mary Jo and I, she has a few people who are basically don't want to get caught up with child support. Right or wrong as that is, I'm not going to put my opinion on that, but and so they don't want to have a bank account. Well, when you have a pay card, it's not really a bank account unless you want to establish it as a bank account. So it is used for some people that are trying to do that, which is not probably the right thing to do. But you do have a few of those individuals in the world. So
and the cards are portable, so they are not attached to Tricom, and they are not actually attached to the staffing company either. They're attached to the employee. So if the employee, you know, were to go elsewhere, they can take that card with them.
Yeah. Mary Jo, do you have anything else? Or maybe we should have some questions. We can open up the questions.
We'll open the floor for questions. If you have any questions, please submit them using the Q&A feature or the chat feature. We did have one question that came in. It says, can you require someone to do direct deposit or a pay card? Or do you have to offer a paper check as an option?
Yeah, I don't believe you have to. Again, Rapid, I know, can walk through every state with you, but it's more and more today that if you follow the ruling that you allow them to pull the funds off the card with no fee
one time,
then that you can then mandate it. And how they do that to get it down to the cents is there are different locations. I know one is the U.S. Postal Service. You can go there and get a money order to pull your funds off the card. You can go to, if it's a Visa card or a MasterCard, you can go to any bank and that offers MasterCard or Visa and pull the funds off the card that way. And then I think they can have those personalized checks kind of to pull it as well.
Yeah.
There's other options out there, but each vendor should know the laws per state. And that's what I would do is go to that vendor, and we can always put you, it is on our website, but we can always give you the information of Rapid Pay Card. They're based out of Florida, but they work in all states, and they're very knowledgeable with the laws and what you can and cannot do with forcing that. So I can't give you a yes or no because every state's different.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Can you guys tell me, maybe each of you can share a comment or a final thought here before we wrap up today, and anything that you would like to share with a staffing company owner if you had an opportunity to, or any of the questions that you may get very commonly from staffing company owners?
I would say the one thing I would stress is if you are a client of ours, utilize our consulting services. You know, there is no fee, it's all included. There's a lot of years and a lot of knowledge here, but we encourage you to look at the reports and use the tools that we went through today. I always joke with new clients when they come on board about the volume of reports you're going to get from TRICOM, which some you need for your internal staff, but then there's really probably four or five that the three of us feel as a staffing owner are the most important for you to monitor your business and your profitability.
Yeah, and I said earlier, you know, many of the clients in 2017 said they had a tough time growing their business, but yet when I dug down with them and asked them to look at their gross profit and the profitability of each client, they were not doing that. They were not looking to fill the orders for clients that were more profitable than the orders that were of clients that were less profitable, or looking at factors of the receivable term. If the receivable term was really high, meaning it was out there at 60 and 75 days, were they looking at that in consideration when they were placing candidates? So you have a limited market of people out there. We all know that. That's not going away anytime soon. So where you're placing those individuals, what customers you're working with, plays more and more in a factor as you want to raise your gross profit and your profitability, your business, and your net income.
I would say make sure that, as kind of what Rick had said, there's a lot of available consulting people here at TRICOM or around you. You know, make sure you're utilizing all your resources that you have available. Sometimes it's really difficult when you're running around fighting fires all day to step back and take a look at the big picture. And sometimes it's something real simple that has always been there that you're not paying attention to. But take that time to step away, to do high-level strategic thinking instead of just fighting each individual fire. Because I think a lot of times you're going to find low-hanging fruit that is really going to help you move forward on your and increase your bottom line.
And the last thing, one more thing is on your workers' comp, we talked about, you know, looking at workers' comp and that, but one area we did not talk about today is a way that could save money, actually put money in your pocket because of the deposits that they require, is looking at the option of pay-as-you-go. That has become more and more available to staffing owners. The insurance industry really likes it because they're getting paid weekly or monthly on your premiums, and it's not – but it's true expense liability compared to this is what they estimate you at the beginning of your policy period, and then you just paying 10 payments throughout the year. Most insurance companies, if you negotiate with them, will lower your deposit requirement at the beginning of the policy period if you go on pay as you go. So, again, this is information we can coach you on, give you some advice on and help on as you go back and forth with your either your broker or your insurance carrier.
Wonderful. Thank you very much for sharing the information. If you have any additional questions, please feel free to reach out to Julianne, Rick, or Mary Jo directly. I've gone ahead and put their contact information up on the slide. Reach any of them at our 800 number or via email. Thank you again for your participation in today's webinar. We will have a recording of this webinar on our website for anyone who may have missed or if you'd like to share it with other people in your office or review it again yourself. It will be on our website at tricom.com, and it's under the Resources tab in the Industry Insider Webinars section. Thank you again for your participation, and watch for information on our next webinar session. Have a great day.
Happy New Year.
Thank you.